wanted to talk today about quite a serious subject, but in a playful way. And it's a subject that comes up a lot for me as a spiritual teacher, and that is how to ground higher frequencies, how to ground them into the body. And what do we mean by higher frequencies? Like peak experiences. So many of us may have had these experiences. I call them epiphanies, breakthroughs of higher consciousness into our through our minds, euphoric feelings, insights, deep insights into behind the veil of reality. And they can really shake us to the core of our being in a positive way, because they open us to the other realms, to the other dimensions, to the truth. And many of us will realize over time, having had these experiences, that the world in which we inhabit, that people take as real, is actually a shadow of what truly is real. And so how, when we have those peak experiences, you know, whether we go away and we have them on retreats, many of us go off on retreats, we do silent retreats or we do whatever, meditation or yoga and things, and that's one way we can do it. Other ways are through plant medicine. Many of us take, you know, have experienced or experimented with plant medicine, things like ayahuasca. That give us a peak experience, that give us a huge breakthrough. So it can be chemical and it can be natural. And yeah, how do we integrate those experiences? Excuse me. How do we integrate those experiences into our everyday lives when we come back into our everyday lives, to the working life, to, you know, our commitments, responsibilities, our family? People, how do we bring that in? It's a real challenge, and I've often contemplated this challenge since I have to deal with it myself when I lead retreats. One enters into a heightened state of consciousness, and then I return to my family, and I have to find a way to seamlessly weave that shift in me into a completely different reality, you know, where there are material, emotional, you know, and just basic responsibilities that we have to deal with, we have to function. And sometimes also the higher functioning is still online when we return. So we have to find ways of like handling that in appropriate ways. Anyway, I think it's one of the great questions of our age, actually. And in a way, it's I have an approach that might be a bit radical, and it's three words: integration through play, integration through play. This came to me one day as a revelation, and I found it incredibly helpful, because what can happen as we come out of a peak experience and then we return to the everyday reality, let's call it, is that we try and kind of reinforce patterns in our life that keep it alive, that keep it going. We try and often we might be tempted to overshare it with those who aren't as receptive to it, or who can't possibly understand where we've just been. It's very difficult to put into words. You know, peak experiences can't easily be put into words. They have to be assimilated. So the first thing is we have to allow ourselves time to assimilate, for the body to assimilate, for the emotions to assimilate it, you know, for our waking reality to assimilate that spiritual experience, those higher frequencies that literally course through our chemistry and our nervous system. And what happens, I find, is that the higher consciousness is very compassionate. So it gives us these experiences and then it leaves us alone. And it leaves us to kind of deal with, like, how are you going to integrate this into your life? And And we need that time. But what do we do with that time? I mean, I've seen people, one approach is to apply some new discipline in life. Maybe you go on a kind of diet, or you go on a, you know, you apply something that kind of maintains that clarity and that sort of perception and that thread. And that's okay, that's fine. Although it can also kind of not be right in a way, because what we need is to normalize the frequency, not to kind of keep it in that pure realm. You know, it can't leave that pure realm, but we need to find ways to normalize it. And so my approach is to be playful. My approach is not to be too serious, too severe on oneself, on others, not to expect much of anyone else. You know, you may not even talk about it to those close to you. That's up to you. You have to kind of feel that through for yourself. That's for each of us to work out. But integration through play is about finding kind of ways to bring it into ordinary people's lives, right? And that means you yourself have to be an ordinary person. You have to play at being an ordinary person. So, you know, I wouldn't be too severe. I'd be the opposite. I'd be soft. I'd flow. I'd be fluid. I would not be too spiritual. I would go to the pub. I would have a drink. I would, you know, eat some pizza. I would do the thing, but, you know, not over the top, because you're kind of coming from this pure space. But just to kind of begin to bring it softly into the world, you know, so that you don't take it so seriously. You don't take yourself so seriously. And what I've found is that really starts to normalize that higher state into our everyday waking consciousness. So I would suggest to be playful, and that means you can't really make a mistake with it. You know, there are no mistakes. So part of that is to just give yourself that space, that yielding quality, that, you know, that approach of, you know, that human approach, so that those higher frequencies from heaven, if you like, can start to come to earth. So in some respects, this is the opposite approach from what some of the teachers might say. They might say, look, retain this state as long as you can, and go on a fast or a diet or all those things, you implement them in your everyday life. And those can be positive things, and in some cases that's true. However, the underlying advice that I would give is to be playful, is to find ways to bring that higher energy into your everyday life. And often what I find is, well, I have children, so it's a bit different with me. I need to kind of maintain that sense of play anyway. You know, if I share things, then quite often it is quite amusing, because I'm sharing things that are from some other reality. And so there's laughter that can come out. And I think that's incredibly healthy to balance, you know, the seriousness of, like, what you've experienced in terms of the clarity, but to balance that with everyday humanity. So integration through play, something for you to consider. Probably you haven't considered it, like to find this more kind of flowing state as you integrate those higher experiences into your everyday life. So I hope that's helpful. I mean, something for you to just play with and consider. You know, for those of us who are exploring these realms, you know, the other thing I do just is when I lead meditations, sometimes I ask people in the middle of the meditation, I can go on a deep visualization journey or something into the body, and then at certain points I just invite people to open their eyes in the middle of the meditation, and you're in a deep inner realm, and then you suddenly open your eyes, but you stay in the inner realm, but you're kind of in and out. And the more you do that, the more you kind of create this transition, this bridge, this seamless bridge between, you know, those realms. So opening your eyes while meditating can also be a powerful thing. And then also when you're not meditating, it helps you to kind of then drop into that pause, which then you realize you're actually in the meditational field, even though you might be outside, if you know what I mean. You're looking out and you're kind of in the outer world as opposed to the inner world. But the more you do those, make those bridges, the less our mind, our brain, our being distinguishes between inner and outer. And then you realize that all these realms are actually can be seamlessly interconnected and bridged. So I'm really interested in how we bridge the inner and the outer, and how we bridge mystical realms with ordinary realms. And I think this is the great teaching of our current age. And many of the teachers of the past, because they haven't focused on this, because the teaching has been based on like an ashram type thing. So you go and you go on retreat, you see that teacher, you spend time with them, and they're in that world all the time. And then you return to your ordinary life. And actually, this is the great teaching. It's like how to bring it into relationship, how to bring it into, you know, working life, how to bring it into the marketplace, how to bring it into conflict, struggle, things that come up, you know, immediately, and they may. And you may think, oh God, I want to go back to that spiritual realm. And actually, that's not the trick. The trick is to bring that spiritual realm down into the mundane, into the material world, into the emotional life, and breathe it in there and bring it alive in there. That is the work. That is the highest work that there is, you know, where the renunciate's path and the householder's path start to come together. It's the mark of the spiritual journey of our day, of this epoch, to do that, to manage it. It's a cutting edge. It's a cutting edge teaching. It's something I'm going to explore more and more as I move on in my journey as a teacher. So playfulness is the first layer of it, just to have a playful spirit, an experiment with how you can bring those two extremes together into this paradoxical place of wonder. Yeah.